Four strong winds that blow lonely, seven seas that run high, all those things that don't change, come what may. In January 2008, I had the pleasure of doing a songwriting workshop with Ian Tyson. This was a special moment for me because I grew up listening to the music of Bob Dylan and Ian and Sylvia. Later on, I got to co-write songs with Ian, songs like Rosa the San Joaquin, Navajo Rug, Claude Dallas, Banks of the Mussel Shell, and I learned a hell of a lot from the man. I think the importance of this film is that Ian really opens up on the songwriting process, and there's a lot of great back and forth you see from one of the last living masters of the song, Ian Tyson. He'd gone through some rough times with a divorce. He was having throat problems, and he was very giving. So here for the first time, Tom Russell and Ian Tyson live in Elko, Nevada at a songwriting workshop.
Great to be here, early morning. And with El Maestro, probably the man who influenced me the most, right at the top of my list. It's an honor for me. When Kevin, who was the director 6 or 8 months ago, called me up and said, would you do a songwriting workshop? I said, no. I just don't like doing them, and I don't like... The process is a question mark to me. There's a little bit of mystical in it, and this and that. It's like Edward Albee, the playwright, once said, it's like asking a centipede who has 56 legs how he moves his legs in unison. He stops to think about it. He can't do it anymore. Songwriting, and a bit of it is like that. And so I said no, but I said if I would do it with Tyson, if we could just get up on stage and talk about what we've been through as writers, take questions. And in that way, to me, it's far more informative for writers. You know, you don't... The other thing is out of a comic book. You too can write great songs. And in the end, it's just down to Towns Van Zandt quote. You want to write songs? Get a guitar, blow everything else off. Love, family, security, comfort, money, safety, future, respect, peace of mind. You'll be rocking and rolling soon.
That's true.
So what I thought we'd do in the way of a little structure, if Maestro goes along with it, is do four parts. Start at the beginning where we started the traditional stuff we sang, which is an important bedrock of what we do. Go on to the first songs, very interesting, especially with regard to Ian. Get to co-writing, everybody's interested in co-writing. How do you do that? And maybe finally we can talk about the songs Ian and I are currently working on and the problems therein. And the difference between, of course, what's the difference between a guy who wrote Four Strong Winds as his first song and now, you know, but I'm sure there's been changes. So that kind of loose structure, and through it all, at occasion, we'll ask for questions.
How's that sound? Sounds good to me.
When Ian and Bob Dylan showed up in the village in the early 60s, they were able to sing hundreds of songs. Old cowboy songs, traditional songs, pop songs. Dylan knew 1,000 songs, and he knew how to steal from melodies, you know. That's the bedrock to writing, I think, and that's where a lot of your early chops come from. And young kids are missing that. I know my daughters who wanted to be songwriters and play guitar, they wanted to skip right ahead to the cover of the Rolling Stone. They didn't want to do what Towns said, you know. Nobody wants to pay the dues. Simple thing from the beginning, I don't care if you're 80 or 8, if you like Hank Williams, learn 10 Hank Williams songs. If you like Ian, learn 10 Ian Tyson songs. If you're at a party, I know when I'm at the ranch at Claudia's, a lot of times they don't want to hear Tom Russell songs. They want to hear me sing Johnny Cash and Hank Williams. It's good party music. And I learned that stuff by playing in the bars, and I know Ian did and Dylan did. That's where you could start. And the first Ian Tyson Ian and Sylvia record I got, must have been 62?
Three.
63. Had this wonderful version of an old cowboy song called Rambler Gambler on it. And I thought, you know the great thing about the old traditional songs, and a lot of them came over from Irish melodies, Scottish melodies, and they were honed and changed, and they were so beautiful, though. You can't get beyond the beauty of the melodies, and then the lyrics were. So Ian sang Rambler Gambler, an old traditional song, and I always love that. I might start, just do a little of that one before I turn it over to you. I'm a rambler, I'm a gambler, I'm a long way from home. You people, you don't like me. Well, just leave me alone. It's a dark night, Lord, it's raining, and the moon gives no light, and my pony can't hardly travel down this dark trail tonight. Well, I once had me a true love, and her age was just 16. Lord, she was the flower of Belton and the rose of Salem. But her parents, they didn't like me, and now she is just the same. And if I'm rid on your books, gal, well, just blot out my name. 'Cause there's changes in the oceans, and there's changes in the sea. There's changes in my true love. There ain't no change in me. 'Cause I'm a rambler, I'm a gambler, I'm a long way from home. You people, you don't like me, they'll just leave me alone.
Really, really morning song.
You can't beat that. There's the entire cowboy code right there. Two things: leave me alone, and her parents didn't like me. That's in a lot of songs. That's in a lot of cowboy songs. Spanish is the loving tongue, but her parents didn't like me.
Got a capo?
Yeah.
Got a pick?
Hey, buy me a beer. The Dylan story, that's good. Want to hear some?
This is a classic, and it was written by Charles Badger Clark, the poetry in this Spanish is the loving tongue. Was written by Charles Badger Clark, correct, Tom?
Yeah, the poem was called A Border Affair.
But there's been endless controversies of who actually wrote the melody. I was taught years ago that it was a very early folk singer, which in back in the era of the kind of art folk music approach, and he was a tenor by the name of Richard Dyer Bennett. I was told that he wrote it, but apparently he did not. And they say that they say Paul Siebel wrote it. I don't know.
No, it was an early guy. I read the name, but never heard of him. And one of the interesting songs while he's getting going here, Between the Poem and the Song. Original Badger Clark poem said it wouldn't work. She was Mex and I was white. Well, they took that out of it, obviously. Changed it to Want Me for a Gambling Fight. Political correctness rears its head.
Spanish years, a loving tongue, soft as music. Light as spray, was a girl that I learned it from when I was living down Sonoma ways. Now I don't look much like a lover, though I sang her love words over. Mostly when I'm all alone, me or ma, me corazón. And on those nights that I would ride, she'd listen for my spurs. She'd throw that big door open wide, raise those laughing eyes of hers. How the hours would get to fly, all too soon I'd hear her sigh. In her little sorry tone, me and ma, me corazón. Well, I ain't seen her since that night, 'cause I can't cross the line, you know, 'cause I'm wanted for some damn gambling fight. And like as not, I guess it's better so. And yet, I've always sort of missed her since that last sad night I kissed her. Lost my heart, left her alone. Adios, mi corazón. To do the ESO ending? Lost my heart, left her alone. Adios, mi corazón.
You can see, though, where lyrically a song like that is it's a very familiar theme among cowboys. The beautiful dark-haired woman at the border. Now, I live in El Paso, Juarez, and I've been going over there every day looking for her. Instead, I find a blonde from Switzerland. So it wasn't exactly true for me, but it's really in a lot of cowboy songs. The classic one being El Paso by Marty Robbins. Yeah. So you know Marty heard all those early songs, and he shifts it and writes a masterpiece. of course, Zarzyski and I, when we were doing this BBC Radio 2 History of the West 6 or 8 months ago, we found Rose's Canteen. It does exist, and there's the hill, and there's the border, and he was sitting there, and he wrote that, and he wrote a lot of other great ones, but all of it based in that bedrock, those bedrock 10 or 12 traditional stories and Irish melodies.
Scots-Irish melodies.
Scots-Irish. Yeah. So as we're heading into the first songs, Dylan was there too. And of course, as Ian will talk about, and he's getting, you know, it's the era once again. I mean, people can forget about Dylan in the 70s and 80s, but he never went away. He's still out there. And
better than ever.
You know, it doesn't matter what anybody thinks, whether he was booed in 65 or right now. I mean, he's big enough to get over all that. But when he showed up, boy, his ears were open, and he moved through that scene like that in 3 years.
You know, he was leaving us in his dust at that point, and is a good thing. But, you know, we realized, I think, we came to the realization that while he turned out 6 great songs, we could probably turn out 1 or 2.
He had the capability of hearing a song, singing it the same night, and then copying the melody and moving on, you know. With God on Our Side was really Patriot Game by Dominic Bien. I'll do an early Dylan song. Show you what he was doing. I call it a cowboy song. It's about a horse thief, but this sounds medieval to me. He just took a medieval thing. I know it's based on a song. I can't tell you what it is. I think it's based on an old folk song called Old Riley that Jack Elliott and Daryl Adams did. But he changed it to 7 curses. And he does a masterful rendition of stuff like this. Old Riley stole a stallion, but they called and they brought him back. And they laid him down on the jailhouse ground with iron chains around his neck. When Riley's daughter got the message that her father was gonna hang, she rode by night and rode by morning, gold and silver in her hand. When the judge saw Riley's daughter, his old eyes deepened in his head. He said, gold won't ever save your father. The price, my dear, is you instead. No, I'm as good as dead, cried Riley. It's only you that he does crave. And my skin would surely crawl if he touches you at all. Get on your horse and ride away. No, father, you will surely die if I don't take the chance and try and pay the price and not take your advice. For this reason, I must stay. The gallows shadow shook the evening. In the night, a hound dog bayed. In the night, the grounds were groaning. In the night, the price was paid. Next morning, he had awoken, she had awoken, to find that the judge had never spoken. She saw that hanging branch had bended. She saw her father's body broken. All these be seven curses on a judge so cruel that one doctor cannot save him, the two healers cannot heal him, and three eyes will never see him, the four ears will never hear him, the five beggars will never buy him, six muses will never fly him, seven deaths will never kill him. All right, stole a stag, but they called and brought him back. Obviously, an old song that he changed, and what he learned, obviously, and what Ian knows, and when we later on wrote stuff like Claude Dallas, that song has in it what Hemingway says, you got to tell them what the weather was like. You got to pull people into your songs and make them feel, and Ian knows that immensely, and Dylan knew that. You know, the best line, that stuff in there, like, the gallows shadow shook the evening in the night a hound dog bayed. That gives me the chills when I heard him singing. And I thought, you got to have that stuff in your song. That, you know, that moves the story forward better than 12 verses about what she looked like, you know. And later when I wrote stuff with Ian, like Claude Dallas and Sky Above, Mud Below, same sort of vibe. It's almost a movie, you know. Ooh. It sounds like Edgar Allan Poe, really. The gallows shadows shook the evening.
That's true, and it's interesting. I'm writing a song that is not finished. It's a work in progress, but it's interesting. Like, it's about the estrangement of my daughter and I for 3 years, and three very painful years for me. And, but I didn't know how to get into it. And strange enough, the whole thing started, a barking dog in the distance. And like you, he's far away from me. Like you, he's gone from me. How long has it been? The dog, that's the image, you know. It's a dog barking at night. Down to the neighbors a mile away, you know, and the coyotes answering. That's right. That's how it's done. That's how it's done.
He also has a new beautiful song about a lioness. And again, it starts with the image of being stripped to Africa, of seeing this lioness with her pride. And then he works that in a wonderful way of moving the metaphor ahead. A lioness and her pride. He's talking about a woman. There's going to be no personal stuff in these songs. There will be no names named and no animals hurt. But
you gotta get, that's you know, when you get past 30, I mean, you can write all that bubblegum shit, but And that's fine. I mean, that's all rhythm. It's just rhythm based. It's dance music and kids. And when you get past 30, and you want to make your living at it, you got to be prepared to expose some of those skeletons, you know, in your closet and in your family's closet. And in the process, you might people sometimes get hurt and so on and so forth. But that's what you got to do. And then the other thing. And the older you get, I think the truth of it for me, it's like, like the realtor says, location, location, location. The songwriter, the writer is read, read, read. That's the deal, read. If I could get away with it and I didn't have that damn ranch, that's all I would do. I would just read and drink Chardonnay, of course.
Thanks for teaching me that one.
Never hit 17. When you play against the dealer boys, you'll find that the odds don't ride with you. Never leave your woman alone. When your friends are out to steal her, years of gamble and lost like summer wages.
I don't want to expose too much, but when I'm at his house, he's got everything from Cowboys and Indians, the Western Horsemen, to the New Yorker. I mean, he knows what's happening in New York City today, so... He reads, Ian reads everything. I'll talk about a little bit of that more, but he gave me a wonderful quote once and said something like he fell in love with the English language at age 50 or something.
40.
40.
That's true.
Years ago. The other thing he just said about, and this is very true with me, if anybody knows what I've written, it's going to eventually get personal. You got to go there. There's no way around it. And it took me about 40 years. I was known as the storyteller. The first song, which we'll talk about in a minute, the first song I wrote really was probably Gallo del Cielo. Where'd that come from? We can talk about that. But stories, corridos, Marty Robbins stories, A, B, C, D. And I shied away from a lot of personal love song, basically because I didn't know a lot about it, number one. I'd had my ass kicked many times. And number two, 98% of every song ever written is about love. And it's been well covered, whether it was by Cole Porter, Johnny Mercer, Ian Tyson, Bob Dylan. If you can't bring something new to the table, you shy away from the table. And then I've been kicked around so many times. I came out with this record, Love and Fear. Here's what I think about it. And discovered a couple wonderful books about the mastery of love. Just simple nuts and bolts stuff. And woman turning to me in a B&B in Northern Ireland after I broke up with this lady after 5 years and just was going, whiny, whine, whine. And this wonderful woman turning to me and said, let me tell you something, Tom Russell. Women have an on and off switch. And when it's off, it's off. Shit. I gotta learn that at age 50. It's true. It's true, any woman will tell you that, but men don't know that. Men are dogs. Men are German Shepherds. You kick, or Labrador Retrievers. You kick them, they'll still come back and go, ooh, kick me again. Women are like cats, man. You only kick a cat once. I'm out of here. And here I learned this at age 50 or 90. It doesn't matter. Men don't learn the basics. Women know all the basics since they're 15.
This could be a reality show, right?
It is. Elko TV.
Phone my agent.
But, and the other thing she said, might as well pass that along, was I said, I just don't know why this woman, I knew I wasn't going to marry her or anything else. It was 6 years ago, I thought. But we're not even friends. The minute it was over, she didn't even friendly. She goes, Tom, sometimes the withholding of affection is the only weapon a woman has. Whoa! Like having two hard balls thrown at your head. Withholding affection. In other words, in this brutal game of love, you turn around and like the cat has left the house and it's over. And women don't tend to want to be affectionate once that's moved on. And so these are things you learn, and they went into all these songs on this record, Love and Fear, 3 years ago, and then I was able to move on. But once I discovered Don, whatever his name is, Don McGill, and just don't take it personal. It's not about you, it's about her. Okay, let it go and all this stuff. Very simple, basic stuff none of us learns. We got to go through it, right? But the bottom line, I'll end with this where I wanted to go, is he's right. Everything, if you want to go back to the Bible, everything is Gnostic, and one of the original Gospels that they took out of the Bible, which they edited out of the Bible, was the Gospel of St. Thomas, which I've always loved. It's a Gnostic Gospel, lots of poetry in it. Jesus said, everything you bring forth from within will save you. Everything you do not bring forth will destroy you. And there's where you lie, you know, as you get on. And you want to bring this stuff out and look at it and get rid of it, that's all. So I'm glad we got rid of that stuff. Why don't we move on and from the traditional and the homework into first songs? And in talking about you sort of edged into talking about Dylan and that. Hey, you got a guitar pick? And it mystifies everybody here as well as me, is when you arrived in the village in the early 60s and you were singing traditional songs with Sylvia, wonderful stuff, where all of a sudden does a song like Four Strong Winds come? Where does it come from? You know.
Well, I've told this story so many times, I'm not sure it's not a complete lie, but you know, if you know, when you repeat something over and over and over, it becomes more authentic with each telling. But I think there's quite a grain of truth. Dylan was there, of course, on McDougal Street with us, and we were all there. There was, you know, Tom Paxton and Len Chandler and Peter Polamere, oh gosh, the Greenbrier Boys, you know, Johnny Harold, and all those people, Ian and Sylvia, and Jack. The next year, Jackie came back from England, and that was a happening. It was really something, and we all played at this place called Gertie's Folk City, which is over near NYU. And anyway, Dylan, this kid was he was doing pretty well. He was copying Woody Guthrie's licks. I mean, he got to know Woody Guthrie. I mean, he went out to Coney Island or wherever it was, and he got to know Woody Guthrie. None of the rest of us did. I didn't even know who Woody Guthrie was. But he was copping Woody Guthrie. And then when Jack came back, he copped Jack in about 24 hours. And then he started, we didn't know what was going on with this kid, because this is a level of creative genius which is so out there that you can't, you know, we didn't recognize it. I certainly didn't. I don't know, what the hell is going on here? And a lot of the stuff, and we got hung up on the fact that he stole stuff. You know, us puritanical Canadians. But we did, yeah. We got, you know, we were quite outraged in some of the songs he stole, and he did steal them. And, but I've learned how to do that too. It was years later, you know. So he, and then he started to produce these incredible things that he, you know, Albert Grossman came into the picture, his famous manager, or infamous manager, and he started producing these amphetamine-enhanced ballads. And we just couldn't, I mean, it was on another plane of genius, you know. But anyway, in the McDougal days, one night, one rainy afternoon, or one evening, I don't remember, we were in the Kettle of Fish, which was our, where we could get cheap beer and cheap drinks, and it was upstairs from the, what was the name of the little coffee house? Famous. We all sang there. It was a great, great place. It was down in the basement. Anyway, he came in and sang me a song, and I say that it's Blowing in the Wind, and it may be, but it may not be. But it was a song that he had just written, and I started to get it a little bit because I thought the imagery was really good. I didn't care for it. I didn't the melody, because he just played very rudimentary guitar, you know, long, 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 you know, and. But it was, I think it was Blown in the Wind, and the images I liked a lot, and I thought, I bet I could do that, you know, because the ignorance of naivete, you know, and I thought, I can do that. So I phoned up, I got a hold of Albert Grossman, our manager, and I said, can I use your apartment this afternoon to try and write a song? And he said, sure, and he had a little apartment over on the east side, and I went over there, and I wrote Four Strong Winds in about half an hour. That's how it happened. And that's the way, the first song, I didn't know that Gallo de Cielo was his first song. You know, that's probably, it might be his greatest song. It might be Tom's, it's certainly up there. You know, it certainly made the short go, that's for sure. And it might be his greatest song. And Four Strong Winds might be my greatest song. I hope not, and he hopes not. But that's kind of that's a mystery too, you know. All you can say about the first song is, there's such a wellspring, there's such a headwaters of experiences and of your life, you know, that it's been untapped, you know. It's like suddenly there's this great big aquifer down there that you can all that stuff. So your chances are, you know, with that, using up that untried, untested, all that stuff, whether you're, you know, 25 or 35, whatever, your chances are pretty good, you know. Your chances are pretty good at writing something decent. But boy, when you get to song number 32, then boy, you see trouble ahead, you know. That's right.
See, what it goes back to our first point. He had a tremendous amount down in the well to draw from. The traditional songs, and we've even neglected to talk about Ian even sings Somewhere Over the Rainbow. So it's not just folk songs and cowboy songs, it's pop songs. And I grew up not only on Tex Ritter songs, who was a sort of a dark influence on me because he's one of the early, he wasn't Gene Autry, he sang Blood on the Saddle. Oh, wow, scary. And I'll tell you a little anecdote about Tex Ritter, but also Broadway musicals. My mom had The Music Man and Flower Drum Song, and I was amazed how you link songs together to make a bigger story, and jazz and pop. So it can, and Mexican corridos, it can come from anywhere. You can hear melodies, and they're not up here, but they're in there somewhere, and they'll come out somewhere. But going back to that scene, which I wasn't around, you know, I wish I was, I wasn't, I was still in school, but looking back on it now, what amazes me is who has survived it. There were dozens of pretty good people around in the early 60s. Guys like Freddie Neal and Karen Dalton and Peter LaFarge, who wrote Ballad of Ira Hayes and wonderful songs. Dozens of them who were accomplished, pretty good songwriters and players, who, and Phil Oakes, you know, sort of pretty good. And what happened to them? A lot of them died, OD, committed suicide. What? Ian's still here. What happened to him, basically, in my mind, was Bob Dylan. What are you going to do when somebody shows up like this and he's singing, you know, a protest song, and then 6 months later, he's singing French Symbolist poetry, and then he's bang, 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 a superstar. People like Pete Seeger, and I don't want to get into that too much, but...
No, don't go there.
No. They just were outraged because they, not only did he move so quickly, he left them in the dust with their movement, which they're still there. And it just broke a lot of people's hearts. Fred Neal, who was a great singer-songwriter, he wrote Everybody's Talking, went down to Florida, you know, and played pinball machines. Paul Siebel, great songwriter, wrote a song called Louise. He drives a squab truck between New York and Washington, D.C. He says, I sing to them little squabbies. But Dylan happened. It didn't intimidate Ian as much, and he's still with us, but it was intimidating. The other thing is Ramblin' Jack Elliott. Oh, it was such an honor for me to get married in a little chapel in Elko yesterday and have two of my heroes, Ian Tyson and Ramblin' Jack, there. But I grew up listening to both these guys. Ramblin' Jack, and Ian will say this too, not only a great jazz folk guitar player, but back in the 50s, and I've come to know a story about a guy he played on the streets with in Europe, Daryl Adams. Jack was over there playing Plains of the Buffalo and Diamond Joe on the streets of London and Paris in 1953, before a lot of people in the scene, this scene, were born, and turning Europe on to cowboy music. And Mick Jagger was going to school one day on the London subway, and Jack was playing on the subway, busking, which Jack has told me comes from the Spanish verb buscar, to search, to play on the street and search for money in a hat. Mick Jagger saw Ramblin' Jack and said, wow, I'd really like to do that, man. Here, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles. That is all by way of saying, when Ramblin' Jack hits this scene, kind of, I don't think a lot of people know that, and, you know, Jack might have an off day or an on day, but in my mind, here's a guy that influenced a generation, and Bob Dylan, who hasn't given him as much credit. He did in his book. So I just wanted to pour that in, and he's still here, and on his good days, you'll see that magic, that Jack Elliott guitar style.
He can still do it. I mean, you're on the train. But and another thing, which you may, some of you I'm sure know, but probably a lot of you don't, the English, you know, all those English rockers in the 60s, they were all immersed in American folk music. Predominantly, the hard rockers, predominantly the black stuff, you know. I mean, the Arthur, all the Crudups and all the stuff that Elvis got directly, you know. But they knew the roots music. They knew it way better. The American kids didn't know it. The Canadian kids didn't know it. I mean, you'd have the odd rebel that did. But the English kids all knew that stuff backwards. They knew all the traditional black and white roots music. That's how Jimmy Page learned how to play the guitar. That's how all those great guitar players, that's how they learned.
It's the difference between that culture, and I play over there quite a bit in Europe, and ours is this culture moves very quickly. Not this culture. This is great. This is a tradition we're sharing, this Western cowboy culture. But the outside culture, our culture, moves very quickly. The radio stuff, not so much over in the UK. You know, they're still to a good song is a good song. You'll turn on a radio station and hear Chuck Berry play behind Bob Dylan and Pavarotti 20 minutes later. Music is music more over there. And so these kids grew up, Mick Jagger and McCartney and all these people, listening to everything, you know, not saying this is hip. And you'll see it in their records later. And Dylan, too. Dylan had that thing. And so when you run out of traditional folk melodies, why not do a blues, you know? I see you got your brand new leopard skin pillbox hat. Everybody still does that. Okay, let's throw in a blues to shake things up. In fact, I do. You know, I write mostly ballads, but you got to have an up-tempo song or they'll be snoring. So, yeah, just go back to the blues, you know. And all these people over there knew that. And it's basic, and you can almost, out of that comes rap. You can play that and just start talking. Yeah, baby, you left me. The switch is off. You bitch. Just kidding. It's too early. I'm sorry, Teresa. Take that out of the film. But to go back to Gallo del Cielo, since he talked about, I was lying a little bit, of course. It wasn't the first song I wrote. And I don't know about Four Strong Winds, but I had written some very bad songs. This might cheer you up. I was playing on Skid Row in Vancouver. This is interesting. I was teaching in Africa, and they sent me home. I go, I can't stand these academic people. You know, I had my Martin guitar. I ended up on the streets of Vancouver because I had friends there. Walked into a bar. I think it was the Smiling Buddha on Hastings Street. Still one of the roughest streets in the world. And this band in the afternoon was playing Hank Williams songs at 3 in the afternoon, and it sounded great. I said, that's what I want to do. Forget this other stuff. And that's what I did. 6 months later, I was playing 8 sets a night, 7 nights a week, for $100 a week for this guy. And we were rotten. I was awful. But I was good at bringing on the strippers. I still have. Ian knows I still have that old carny capability. Let's bring out Spongy the Rubber Girl. And the Sword Swallowers and all. I liked it. I loved it. I still love it. You know? Let's bring out Onyx and there was an act called Onyx and Pharaoh. Onyx was a huge black guy. Muscled up, Vaseline. And he comes out. All we did was a 20 minutes of drum solo. In the bag, he has a giant boa constrictor. Pharaoh. And these were Native American bars. This is going to lead to my first song. Native American bars. Even Chief Dan George used to come into this bar, so I would play IRAs. The drums would roll, and Onyx would run around yelling at the Indians, and they knew what was coming. A lot of Native Americans up there were deathly afraid of giant snakes. So right at the denouement, or the high point, he pulls out the snake and runs up at everybody. And half of them leave. So the bar thing wasn't happening. They fired him. But
I guess.
One anecdote, and again, I know I promised that no animals were hurt during this rap. But one night we're in a place called the Club Zanzibar, and he comes out, and it's his 6th set, and I noticed the bag wasn't moving. But he goes and does the thing, and he pulls the snake up, but the snake isn't moving. And I realized for a couple days the snake had died, but he went right out like a trooper and performed with a dead snake. That's show business. But where I was leading was, no, Gallo del Cielo was written in 77, 78, and, but I was writing horrible songs, like strung out like the tightest wire on a frozen barbed wire fence, that I was trying to slip into my sets. And they were working, and but the first songs I wrote were about those people that inhabited those bars, Native Americans. And I wrote a pretty bad song called "Here's Your Indian, Mr. White Man. He's drunk as well you know. Take him to your mission. Dress him up in welfare clothes." It's really bad. And it won an award. I thought, as we all do, shit, this is easy. And then I wrote another one called "The End of the Trail. Mama, pack up your medicine bag." And that won a giant song contest. The American Song Festival lasted 2 years. $5,000 and a free trip to New York and a TV show. And I thought, this is easy. This is easy. And so I thought, I'm going to write a novel now, too. And so I wrote a novel in 3 months based on my life experiences on Skid Row. Honky Tonk Stardust Cowboy, it was called.
Wow.
Really bad. Didn't know where to send it. Looked in the Yellow Pages. The best agency was the William Morris Agency. Sent it off. Got a note back saying, this is pretty good. We can chop. I thought, that's it. I'm a novelist. I'm a songwriter. So, you know, 25 years later, fast forward, and, you know, I'm still working some bars, you know, in the 15 years later, in the mid-80s, still working the honky-tonks. It wasn't that easy. Reality sat in, you know. They weren't very good songs. They were a start. Novels stunk. I moved to New York and wrote novels for a couple years. None of them, except for one, got published. Drove cab for a year. Picked up scary people. And then wrote Gallo del Cielo, which probably a light bulb went off in my head. I'm just going to get back to my roots. I love Mexican corridos. There's a lot of corrido singing this weekend. Running, corrido. Corrida is the running of the bulls, la fiesta brava. But corrido is running, long running story of linked verses. The Mexicans have a wonderful way of telling stories. I said, I'm just going to write this long sort of saga. I don't know why I have this in my head, but I know I wrote it in a garage in Mountain View, California. And it linked a few stories that I'd heard up in the mountains, the Sierra Madre Mountains of Mexico in Creole, from an old professor who knew Pancho Villa. And he didn't tell me much, but he told me a few colorful things, like Pancho Villa didn't drink hardly at all. He didn't have all those stereotypical things. He was a world-class womanizer, though, and his shtick was, his thing was, he would ride into town with his 2,000 compadres and the guns and look for the most beautiful rich girl and the father, and then he would tell the father, you give me your ranch for the revolution, or I marry your daughter, either one. And this guy told me this, and then he'd ride on to the next town and do it again, and he had 30 or 40 wives on the road. Until somebody just said, hey, you gotta chill out with this, you know, you're losing your respect. So this guy up in the mountains was telling me these stories, and that kind of formed the basis of Gallo del Cielo, you know. I'm gonna go out and fight this fighting rooster up the coast of California. I got all the geography in there. That's the only way I can remember the song. It goes San Antonio, San Diego, Santa Barbara, up the coast, see, Santa Clara, and ends in San Francisco. And if I get lost some nights, which is not a good thing to do with an audience, I remember the towns. But I had that story of a guy stealing a rooster, but I fell back on that Pancho Villa color, you know.
When I was living in a little cabin in Alberta, I was cowboying and training horses, and I received a copy of his Gallo del Cielo, and it blew me away, and I decided if I ever cut an album, if I ever go back into music, I'm going to record that, and I did.
Yeah, and I had written Gallo del Cielo, as we talked about yesterday, 1978. I had really never met Ian except for being an Ian and Sylvia fan and going to the shows, and they blew everybody away. they weren't Peter, Paul, and Mary. It was pretty authentic. And but I never really talked to him, and I sent him a bunch of stuff, and maybe Peter had sent Ian a record of mine that had Gallo del Cielo on it. I had taken that song to Nashville, and people, the Nashville thing, and I don't want to hammer that, but they would say, ah, interesting. Song about a fighting rooster, very interesting. We'll get back to you. Horrified. But Ian loved it, and he's the first one that informed me it was actually a polka beat, that I had written a polka with corrido overtones, and he recorded it on old corrals and Stagebrush.
What am I, Teresa? I am thinking of you now in Santa Barbara. I have $1,500 and the good luck of your picture framing. Tonight I'll put it all on the fighting spurs of Gallo del Cielo. And then I'll return to buy the land we have stole from father long ago. Now the moon has gone to hiding, and the lantern light spills shadows on the fighting sand. Hey! Where a wicked black named Zorro faces Gallo del Cielo in the night. But Carlos Zaragoza fears the tiny crack that runs across his rooster's beak. Hey! And he fears he has lost the $50,000 riding on the fight.
We're getting now to Navajo Rug. A guy, a big-time cutting horse guy, flew into New York in 1986 and to do a private party.
His birthday party.
Ian needed some amps, and I had a band at the time, a good honky-tonk band, and I helped Ian out with some Fender Reverb amps, and he came, or we met somewhere. We did a gig together at the old Bitter End in the Village. It was like, this is the place these guys came out of, and here I was doing a gig with them. And he had a great cowboy band, and Cindy Church and a lot of people. And we got together, and Ian had a few days off. I'll try to keep this short because it's pretty funny. But I said, come over tomorrow, you know, to my place. Well, Ian didn't know Tom was living the bohemian life in a place called... The Bunker. An old-time songwriter named Pat Garvey, who wrote a great song called The Lovin' of the Game. I don't know where he is now. But he said, look, if you don't got any money, go to a city. If you're in New York, go to a marginal neighborhood, like a Puerto Rican neighborhood. Find an abandoned storefront. Offer to rent it for $80 or $100. Paper the windows over and build yourself a loft bed and a desk on some bricks with a door, and you're in business. Start writing or pretending to be a bohemian or something. But it was the way to get by in New York in 1981, where I was driving a cab. I was married and had two kids at the time, and it was a rough time. But I had this bunker to write in, and I was doing a lot of writing. And I told Ian, come over tomorrow. He goes, I'll be there. Just give me the address, and I'll get a cab over. And so the next night, about 7, the sun had gone down, and the pit bulls were howling. And Ian calls up. He says, Russell, where the hell are you? And I can't find you. I'm in a phone booth. I'm surrounded by Puerto Ricans. And he had his boots and cowboy hat on. I knew now that I had him in my space. And I went and rescued him, and we walked through the pit bulls, and we got back to, I lived on the corner of 5th and 5th, in a rough neighborhood, and very rough. And but before we went into the bunker, we went by a voodoo store with candles in the window. I pushed him in there. I said, here we are, home sweet home. And now he's really shocked. And then I said, just kidding, and we went to the bunker, and I had... Luckily, I had 3 bottles of pretty good red wine, or 2, or whatever. We always exaggerate, but we popped them open and just got acquainted. And I remember I had a little tape recorder, and he ended up singing me 35 verses of The Castration of the Strawberry Rum. Wonderful stuff I'd never heard. You would never, you know, want to do it in a mixed audience, but I knew my brother had known it, but he had all the verses, and Buckaroo version. And we chatted and hung out for 3 or 4 hours, had a great time, and he was ready to go back to Manhattan and we're in his palatial hotel and back across the river. And it was a wonderful time in New York, really. Giuliani came in and thank God he cleaned up the whole city, but it was rough in 81.
Tom said, because I remember it very, I remember it distinctly. Tom said, I got this idea about making love on a Navajo rug. That's exactly what he said. I got this idea about making love, and I said, "Wow! I mean, now that is a, you know, isn't it's just great, you know? I mean, it's love, you know, lust and all that good stuff, you know, and it then he brings in the West with Navajo rug. I mean, Navajo rugs weren't everywhere then, you know. They were special, you know. They were up there. So when he said making love on a Navajo blanket, I thought, wow, what? That's fabulous. And it was, you know. So we wrote it. We wrote it long distance. I finished it in a Super 8 in Fort Worth, Texas, about a month later. Tom had done the verses. He had the verses all roughed up. But he didn't have a, you know, it's our strength, if we have one as collaborators, is I bring a melodic thing to the chorus, which I was able to do with Navajo Rug, very simple, but you know, I just lift that chorus was there, so, and we got it done, and it came out in Canada, and oddly enough, it did not go as high. It went pretty high on the charts, but the one that went high on the charts was the run of was a song about Tom's brother Pat, Cowboy Pride. That's the one that really, really went high on the charts. And Michael Martin Murphy cut a very nice version of it on his big selling album. So, but yeah, that's where Navajo Rug came from. And you know, I just, you know, hooks we call them. Hooks like that, making love on a Navajo rug, they don't come along. You know, they're not like buses. They don't come along every day. And when they do, you want to grab them. Go with them.
Let's just do a verse
before. Sure.
Well, it's three eggs up on whiskey toast, home fries on the side. Wash it down with that roadhouse coffee. It burns up your inside. It's just a cane caught at a diner. Well, the waitress I did love. Well, we sat in the back neath an old stuffed bear in a worn-out Navajo rug.
Now Jack the boss, he quit at 6. Then it's Katie, bar the door. And she pulled down that Navajo rug and she spread it across the floor. And I saw lightning across the sacred mountains. Saw the dance of the turtle doves lying next to Katie on that old Navajo rug.
Aye, aye,
aye. Katie, shades of red and blue. Aye, aye, aye. Katie, whatever became of the Navajo rug and you?
Katie,
shades of red and blue.
That's it.
And also, you know, the other things that are hard to define, it was a great song, if we do say ourselves, but it was at the right time, you know. That was if that song came out now, it probably wouldn't fly. It probably wouldn't go anywhere. Maybe it would, I don't know. But, you know, the timing thing is, and you can't, there's nothing you can do about that, you know. You write them and you write them from your heart, and you put them out there, and that's it. They're like your kids, you know. Off they go, you know. And but it was the song for the time, in the mid-'80s. Elko was starting. There was a genuine renaissance, a cowboy renaissance, and thank God it happened, because here we are 20 years later, it's over.
When we covered Four Strong Winds, we didn't really mention Someday Soon. Is there any brief story of where that Someday Soon came? Obviously, it's a song that's been covered by 10,000 female vocalists Someday Soon.
Well, Judy Collins was responsible for that song becoming successful. Well, actually, her boyfriend at the time was Stephen Stills, you know, of Crosby, Stills, and Nash & Young. and who I really don't know. I've only met him a couple of times. Nice, very creative guy. But he loved the song, and he tried to get Judy, who was hot then, to record it, and she wasn't interested. And but they were lovers, and so he induced her to cut it, and she cut it, and it slowly took off as a standard, and then of course went on and on and on. Finally, Susie Boggess did the definitive version, and was a huge hit. But that song was written in Sylvia Tyson's six floor cold water walk up down in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, right down near the Williamsburg Bridge. She loved that place. They had cockroaches that I couldn't saddle in that place. You know? I mean, I wouldn't even try to ear one down, you know. And then New York, Tom's right. New York got rougher after that, very rough. She left when the strange odor in the next apartment was a deceased drug user, and we could see the writing on the wall. But that's what that song was written. In 1964, I guess.
Yeah. Good years. She told me, I got to know Sylvia later and we collaborated. Actually, I got to co-write with her too, so I could have died there. I wrote a bunch of songs with both Ian and Sylvia. But she told me a funny anecdote when Ian wrote Four Strong Winds, because Bob Dylan had said, wrote Blowing in the Wind, and Ian said, I can do that, and wrote Four Strong Winds. Sylvia, not to be outdone, being a great songwriter, she said she got into the bathtub and filled it up with warm water, got into the bathtub at the Earl Hotel.
A wonderful place.
In Washington Square. This is where it was all happening in New York City. Because she got in the bathtub, because that was the only place the cockroaches couldn't get her, and wrote You Were On My Mind, a huge song. So you can imagine that here's a day in New York City where Bob Dylan this week wrote Blowing in the Wind, Ian wrote Four Strong Winds, and Sylvia wrote You Were On My Mind. You know, that's the kind of chemistry that was happening there.
I wrote a lot of songs there, several songs there, and hanging out with Jack Elliott, and it would have been, I wish Tom had been there. I think Tom was probably in Africa at the time with the Peace Corps. It was well before we'd met, but it was a great scene, and Jack and I were the two, Jack Hill and I were the two sort of resident cowboys in the village. You know, there'll never be another time like that. It's wonderful to look back on it, remember it, yeah.
But one day we had a magic day up in the Rockies. Ian used to have the use of this cabin way out away from the ranch, 40 miles, mm-hmm. And it was wonderful because you were his ranch is isolated, but you were double isolated. You were only out there to write, and we'd take sandwiches out there. This was when I was first getting to know Ian, and I was very intimidated. I had to open all the gates. The word gunsel was used quite a bit. You got to go through it. I thought I'd gone through all that with my brother. No, you know, I had to go through it, and you know what? I needed to go through it. And we arrived at the cabin. You know, we'd get out there early, about 8:00. And what really amazed me about looking at a master songwriter, and I knew every one of his songs from 1962. I'm very familiar with his stuff, and that everything was ready to go on his writing desk. Were the pens and pencils and, you know, the dictionary, the thesaurus, a road atlas in case we wanted to check, which we did. He helped me with Blue Wing. We went from Walla Walla to Wenatchee. We checked it. Everything was muy autentico, and everything was there. I mean, we were there to write. Dictionary of quotations. And Ian loves to read, of course, and he loves to go back. And I'll tell you a funny thing, a quick 10-second thing. He's reading Bartlett's familiar quotations one day for about 20 minutes. And he looks up at me and he says, Tennyson, man, he knew a hell of a lot about love. And I looked at him and said, Alfred Lord? And he goes, shit. No, Russell, Manny Tennyson. He owns a dry cleaning service, you idiot. You fucking Gunsel. And that's the way it started. No, Manny Tennyson. He's got a place on Flatbush Avenue. What? You know, this is what I had to go through. And I remember another. You like that, don't you? Bastard.
I didn't do that.
He doesn't anymore. But these were the dudes. And these were great dudes. Growing up, I mean, guy I idolized. I mean, as much as I love Bob Dylan, I never idolize him. I don't write like Bob Dylan. I write a lot more like Ian melodically and sing a lot. So here's this guy telling me this stuff. But I wrote it all down. The other thing, we're working on Blue Wing or working on a love song. He goes, go walk out there and think about it. You're thinking too much. And I got about 50 yards away, and I'm just going like this, you know, love. And he goes, God damn it, Russell. He yells from the front door. He goes, you don't have to be Leo Tolstoy every day. Just, I mean, this stuff is flying out of his mouth. You know, I'm sitting there, that's right. You don't have to be Leo Tolstoy. So you talk about going to school and back in. And then the same day that he said, oh, we're stuck. Tell me some stories about your brother. And I go, oh, my God. I don't want to get into all the personal stuff. But here he goes down the road, makes all the mistakes, runs off with the waitress, has a beautiful wife who has everything, and blah, you know, all the mistakes, and he onward. But we all still love him. But Tyson says, that's good enough. Go take a walk. And he writes Cowboy Pride, a letter to my brother, a wonderful song. But I was working on this song, Blue Wing, about a guy I had met on the Skid Row in the bars I was playing in Vancouver that had a Blue Wing tattooed in his arm. And I found out later he died on Skid Row in L.A. And then fictionally, we put him going down the coast to Wenatchee. Tyson came up with, maybe he'd pick apples in Wenatchee. Yeah, he probably would. And he'd go to a cheap motel in Seattle. And he helped me see all these books on his desk, the Road Atlas. I mean, you don't want to get stuff like that wrong. And this song has resonated. I mean, it didn't go away. A lot of people like the song. I'll do you a verse and chorus. What do you think?
Go on.
And then we'll talk about Navajo Rug. But you're not going to sit across from Ian Tyson and write a song like this and write anything false, because it's just not going to happen. You know, he's not going to let you. He would leave me up there sometimes, and he'd go back to the house for a couple days. And I remember one night he said, see that book up there? Teddy Blue Abbott's. We pointed him north, one of the great books of the West. If you want to know where Larry McMurtry gets a lot of ideas, read We Pointed Him North. He said, there's a song in there. I'll be back in the morning. Get some of it done. And don't go in the basement where the good red wine is, you bastard. So I finished this song, and we started Banks of the Muscle Show based on We Pointed Him North. Here's a little of Blue Wing. He had a blue wing tattooed on his shoulder. Well, it might have been a bluebird, I don't know. But he gets stone drunk and talk about Alaska. The salmon boats and 45 below. He said he got that blue wing up in Walla Walla, where his cellmate there was little Willie John. And Willie, he was once a great blues singer. And Wing and Willie wrote him up a song. They said it's dark in here.
Can't see the sky,
but I look at this blue wing and I close my eyes. Then I fly away
beyond the walls,
up above the clouds,
where the rain don't fall on a poor man's dream.
Well, they paroled Blue Wing in August of 1963. He moved north picking apples to the town of Wenatchee. Winter finally caught him in a rundown trailer park on the south side of Seattle, where the days grow gray and dark. And he drank and he dreamt a vision of when the salmon still ran free, and his father's fathers crossed the wild old Bering Sea, and the land belonged to everyone. There was old songs yet to sing. He now it's narrowed down to a cheap hotel and a tattooed prison wing. Hey, it's dark in here, can't see the sky, but I look at this blue wing and I close my eyes. Oh, to fly away beyond these walls, up above the clouds, where the rain don't fall on a poor man's dream. Hey, 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 hey. Well, he drank his way to L.A. That's where he died. But no one knew his Christian name, and there was no one there to cry. But I dreamt there was a funeral, preacher and an old pine box. And halfway through the sermon, old Blue Wing began to talk. He said, it's dark in here, can't see the sky, but I look at this blue wing and I close my eyes. Then I fly away beyond these walls, up above the clouds, where the rain don't fall on a poor man's dreams. Hey, hey. On a poor man's dreams. Hey, hey. On a poor man's dreams.
Thank you.
The difference between Ian and I, and maybe I'm on the right. I don't think Ian finger picks. He's a flat picker. That's a big thing. It took me 20 years to figure that out. Ian and Sylvia never finger picked, whereas I finger pick, and if you're solo and stuff, this is called Travis picking, a lot of you know. So I'm playing the bass line a bass player would play with my thumb, and the melody with my, and that's a one-man band thing, you know. It goes back to Merle Travis and the old guys, because you can accompany yourself. But I end up writing a lot of songs that way, too. Ian, as a flat picker, is a groove meister. He flat picks to a metronome, even, because he's putting it right in there in those great dance grooves. And that's two different approaches. And I can flat pick a little, but he's right in the pocket.
I don't write melodies on the guitar. I never write a melody on the guitar. I used to, you know. I think probably, you know, somebody soon was probably written on it. I don't know. But it's a trap, you know.
Yep.
You're melodically trapped by the limitations of your playing. Now, if you are Segovia, then you can probably write wonderful melodies on the guitar. So if I'm having a melodic problem, the first thing I do at the old stone house at Tombstone, I put the guitar down and I go out and hike, because I won't get sucked in by the guitar. The guitar will suck you in and you'll just end up writing the same thing that you wrote, you know, the guitar told you to write, you know.
So his melodies are in his head.
Does that make sense? I don't know if that.
Your hands fall into bad habits, and even like Ian will say, you always want to, when you're in G, you want to go to D, and Ian will say, screw the five, don't go there. Force yourself, right, not to go there. Go somewhere else. Try out some minors. Write a song in a minor key.
That B minor's been very good to me.
That one right there.
A dear friend of ours by the name of Carl Brouse, who died, used to say that, Ian, that E minor has been awfully good to you.
It's a different color, you know. It's kind of, ooh, what's happening now? Bridges, choruses, you know. This is getting boring. You know? A little minor bridge that takes it over there and then back into the song. You know? More questions. They're all good, too.
I have a question for you, and that's not being a songwriter or a performer, I wonder, how do you get up on stage week after week, year after year, and bust out another round of guile? I mean, how do you keep it fresh for yourself?
Alimony.
There you have it. Yeah.
The money is hemorrhaging out of the bank. It's true. No, to be quite, another side of that is, I'm sure both Ian and I are gonna drop on stage whenever. We love this. I mean, I'm speaking for him and myself, but we love it. I mean,
That's right.
If I could do it, I'd do it. My new wife wants me to keep it down to 150 dates a year, but boy, I would do 200. It's tiring and all that, but it's invigorating. And why is Dylan and why is Merle Haggard out there every night? You think they have to be? No. They love it. They didn't get, no great people like that got into it to make $1 million. They got into it because this is fun and invigorating, and this is what we do. We don't do a lot of other things very well. At least I don't. I write and paint, and that's about it. Next question.
Tom, you just got married, and here's this whole life ahead of you, and everything is opening up. And are you writing about that? Because mostly you've written songs that are maybe not so hopeful, but are you writing about the good stuff coming?
I told you, you see.
Are you writing about the good stuff coming at you?
Yeah.
And Ian... you're older than me, but I still got to have some hope that you're looking for another leg of the journey here with love. And are you writing about that coming at you?
Oh yeah, I am. Yeah, you know, I guess it was Hank. You know, Hank Williams said, you know, heartbreak sure as hell don't hurt your songwriting. Yeah. And he's right. He's right.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I'm having a period of time now that I'm enjoying writing a lot. It's kind of my life, the lifeline I'm holding on to. Yeah.
We'd like to thank you all. They were great questions, and it was fun. Ian Tyson.
It's called The Roan Mare, a.k.a. Elko Blues. Hope to see you again down the road, everybody. Well, I ride the roan mare, I'm free. I ride the roan mare, I'm free. When I lie awake, sleep won't come, 'cause my baby, she's gone. The night it closes in. When I ride the bay star, I'm free. When I ride the bay star, Lord, I'm free. When the mama the pawn in the wind died, 'cause the babies are gone, all the night goes easy. Guitar. I believe I'm going back to Elko Town, and I'll be standing back in a brand new hat, and my money in my hand. I hope that my old friends come around, come around. And when I
I die, just let me go naturally. When I die, I want to go naturally. You know, I've traveled this world as a free man. One thing I ask of you, oh, don't let them put them goddamn tubes way down in me. No, 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 no. But I ride the wrong man, I'm free, free. But I ride the wrong man, cause I'm free. Now when the mama, they're ballin' in the weaning time, cause their babies are gone. The night it closed easy on me. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Thanks a lot, everybody. The great music of Tom Russell. Thank you all for coming. God bless you.